I'm interested to answer the question about how we think about what we want. But specifically, I'm interested in life's big decisions. Where am I going to buy a house? What should I study? Who should I befriend? These are life's, what do we do when we close our eyes, concentrate deeply, and consider life's major decisions? And so to answer this question, we're building a model in the lab with non-human primates using monkeys. And we use these animals because they're cognitively sophisticated. But it's still very, very hard to make a monkey concentrate. And a consequence of that is that decision-making tasks are very, very simple. This is an example of one that we commonly use. You have an animal that is looking at a computer screen, then a red dot appears to start the trial, and then two icons will appear, and these icons predict different rewards, large, small. In this case, 0.2 and 0.4 milliliters of juice. He chooses the bigger one, and as you can imagine, this doesn't take very long, less than a second. So this is a good model of, you know, how we pick between two things, but not a good model of how we deliberate. And the thing that's really missing from this study is complexity. By complexity, I specifically mean computational complexity. And this is defined as the computational resources that we need to solve a given problem. But it's not just computer scientists and mathematical physicists who need to consider complexity. You know, in fact, our daily lives are suffused with complexity. When we think about these major decisions, we have to balance, you know, between available resources, available options, future consequences, and these combinatorial considerations generate significant computational complexity. But even mundane tasks like scheduling, route planning, and budgeting can generate fantastic complexity. To give you an example, imagine that you want to go camping, and you want to go camping to contemplate the Milky Way. But before you can contemplate the Milky Way, you have to contemplate the knapsack that you need to fill so that you can survive in the wild, right? And no matter how big your knapsack is, it's finite. And so you have to choose items to put in and what items to leave behind. And so you want to choose the most valuable subset of items to put into the knapsack. But let's look a little closer. So I've highlighted two items, right? A coffee maker and a coffee cup. They're only really of value when you take both of them. So not only do you need to think about the items that fit into the sack, you need to think about combinations. So on this picture, there are 20 items, and that means that there are over a million combinations. There's no way that we're able to consider all of these things. And note that there's no pants on this picture, right? So as you add items, the complexity will quickly exceed the known atoms in the universe. So we need a way to get through this. To understand this, we trained monkeys to fill knapsacks. Virtual knapsacks, but they're knapsacks nevertheless. And to give you an idea of how this works, this is the screen right now is just as the screen the monkey would see. A red dot appears, and when it appears, he touches it to start the trial. And when he touches it, he sees this. Five icons and a bunch of gray boxes across the top. And these icons have value, just like in the simple task. But the gray boxes across the top, that's the knapsack. That's the virtual knapsack. And it shows him how much juice he can collect on a given trial before it breaks. So when he selects an item, we fill up the knapsack, we provide visual feedback. And when he picks another item, we fill it up even more. And now you see it's pretty full, so he should stop. And when he does, at the end of the trial, he gets a big drop of juice, 0.75. The limit is always 0.8, so he has to stay under that. If he doesn't stop, but selects another item, the knapsack breaks and he doesn't get rewarded. So this task incentivizes the animals to find the most valuable subsets and sometimes to think about combinations. So the first question that we want to answer is, how does the complexity of the task influence the monkey's performance? So what I'm showing you here on the y-axis is his performance. It's just the reward he gets on trials divided by the total he could get, so it's the percent optimal. And on the x-axis, we've divided the trials into three different types, low, medium, and high complexity. And you see that, as we expect, as the complexity goes up, the performance goes down. And this is good. This is what we want. We want to be able to challenge the animals and see that that complexity has an influence. But also notice that the performance is, you know, 65 to 70 to 80%. And a lot of you now are wondering, well, this is a monkey sitting in front of a computer screen, and he's probably just hitting things at random. But actually, this is much higher than we would get if you take such a strategy. So the monkey is solving these problems. And that begs the question of, how do the monkeys solve the problems? And so if we look at one particular problem, we can look at several solutions. How could the monkey solve this? Well, really simple. He could take the largest item available, which is 0.6, and then he could take the next largest item available, which is 0.15, and he could stop. And he'd get 0.75 milliliters of juice. And he never, ever has to think about combinations. This is a simple solution, and so we call this the low-complexity solution. But to this same problem, there's a different solution, right? He could ignore the biggest item, and he could search for combinations. And when he searches for combinations, he can actually find an even better outcome, 0.8 milliliters, the optimal outcome. To do so, he had to think about combinations. So we call this the high complexity solution. So there's multiple ways to solve the problem. But I don't really care about the solutions. I care about the step-by-step process that he takes to solve the problem. Those step-by-step processes are called algorithms, right? I already told you the algorithm for the low-complexity solution. You take the biggest one, you find the next biggest one that fits, and you do that until you can't fit anymore. It's simple, it's step-by-step, and you only have to think about things one at a time. In contrast, if you have to think about combinations, the algorithms, the step-by-step procedure, become more complex. And so instead of low-complexity solutions and high-complexity solutions, we're going to talk about low-complexity algorithms and high-complexity algorithms. So the fundamental difference between these these types of algorithms, right? So if we're looking at the low-complexity algorithm, right, we need to find the biggest item. There's five items, so require five operations, right? Just find the biggest one. But if you're going to search the space of combinations for five items, that's 32 operations. So we might expect that when the monkey applies a highly complex strategy or algorithm, that he takes longer. And so we measure the time between when we show him the problem and when he makes his first selection. And indeed, what we see is that as the complexity of the internal mental process increases, the time the monkey takes to deliberate also increases. So on the y-axis here, we've separated trials into low, medium, and high behavioral solutions. And we can see that the monkey invests more time when the trial is more complex. In his behavior, he invests more time in high complexity algorithms, searching for combinations. And so the answer to how do the monkeys solve complex problems is that they approximate in very fine detail, right? So as the number of operations increases, the time spent deliberating increases. And this relationship suggests that, you know, algorithm in the brain is more than a metaphor. It's what the brain is actually doing. So they approximate, in very fine detail, efficient computer algorithms. So you have a monkey, they can do easy stuff and they can do hard stuff. How do they decide the complexity of the algorithm that they apply to a situation? And the answer is pretty simple and pretty beautiful. They adapt to the complexity that's required. So now I've simply divided all of the behavior that the monkey had into low complexity trials and high complexity trials. And on the y-axis, I'm showing you the probability of choosing to use a complex solution. And what we can see is that the monkeys are more likely to use a complex algorithm when it is required to get the best rewards. So, the takeaways from what I've shown you are that monkeys can flexibly use different algorithms to achieve optimal outcomes, and that the relationship between the number of operations and the deliberation time suggests that something like these very efficient computer algorithms are actually computed by the brain itself. And finally, that monkeys and probably other primates like ourselves are able to adapt our strategy and therefore our effort to get the best reward but not expend too much thinking. So, going back to how do we think about what we want? By adding complexity into these behavioral tasks, we are able to show that primates use combinatorial reasoning, and they use it in a very evolutionarily adaptive way. And so they adjust their behavior to the requirements. And this is a very psychological answer, and as we move forward, we'll be recording from neurons to provide a neuronal mechanistic answer. And this is very important because, you know, decision-making and making good decisions is crucial for mental health. So understanding the neural mechanisms of decision-making is the key to providing relief to some really debilitating disorders. But I'll leave you with a final thought, which is that if we can learn, answer the question, how do we think about what we want, we can also get at an even more fundamental question, right? Which is, how do we think? And that has implications beyond healthcare into philosophy, human-level AI, and the future.